Hey, good morning also from my side. I'm happy to be here and thanks for the invitation to organizing this awesome meeting. And I'm going to talk about passive BCIs and what differentiates them from the classic BCI approach, how I would call it. And specifically how to use BCIs for different means in human-computer interaction. So I'll start with a background and basic definitions that we're all on the same page. And then as a section, I have a section about direct control. How can we replace manual input with BCIs, which is the mostly investigated endeavor so far. But then the part after that, I'll speak about passive BCIs, and they, in my understanding, revolutionize the way how we can interact with machines. And in the end, I'll give a conclusion and outlook. But please dive with me. So ask questions. Feel free to interrupt me anytime when you don't understand something or have a question or a remark. Be not shy. So the main theme of this deep dive is interaction. And I would like to start with questions. How do we communicate with technology now? How do we do that? How do we make the technology do what we want it to do? And how could we, in future, communicate with technology, or what other options are there? And, of course, specifically, how can we use BCIs to do that? Let's go back to 1952, to Fitz, who defined the term of human machine systems, and he defined it in a way that he says we have two entities, the human and the machine, and the human is great in understanding the situation, doing higher cognition, dealing with errors or with not foreseen things, while the machine, if properly instructed, can do things very properly, very precisely, use a lot of force or with high speed. So when we think about a car, we have some autopilots today, but if you don't use that, the car is quick and can carry a lot of things and get us far around the world, but it still needs a driver. And that was the idea of Fitz, that he said, if we can optimize the communication between these two entities, we can do something great. And when we look at human-machine systems today, we can have a look at this control room of a power plant, where you see a lot of information is integrated on the screens, and it's presented in a way that humans can really understand them easily, and we spend a lot of effort into aggregating this information in a way that humans can understand it. But when you look at the communication from the user, from the operator to the machine, you still see a mouse and keyboard. So that's a really low bandwidth communication. And that's basically the same thing as the XY position indicator introduced by Engelbart in 1964. So there is not much progress. I mean, we have touch screens now, we have voice control, but still, that's basically the same thing. We have to translate our ideas into the language of the machine that is doing what we want it to do. Okay, but what is the theoretical view on human-computer interaction? It's a closed-loop thing. So we have a human and we have a machine. And let's start with a human. We create output by typing something, by translating our ideas into manual actions. And that is then going through a interface, a boundary to the world of the machine, and is understood as input, translated to input for the computer. And that changes the computation of the computer or the machine, which then creates another output, which is going through an interface, which could be a monitor or a sound or whatever, going back to the human. Then we change our cognition based on that, so we have a closed-loop system. But we should never forget that this is also integrated in a context, so something which we can't model. If you want to model a human-computer interaction, we, of course, do this here, but the context itself is something we can't control. So if the power turns off, my computer will probably not work, or the projector here would probably not work. But if you want to go for a new concept, if you want to use something different than the mouse and computer, what can we do? Well, we can go for new adaptivity. So the machine could adapt to a neural state. So we get rid of the mouse and use our brain the machine assesses changes in our user state and is then adapting it itself to support us in ongoing interaction. But how to define this new interface? We have a brain, we have a machine, and we are not allowed to use anything else from the body, no other signal generated by the body, but the brain. So we have to create output directly from the brain and translate it into something the machine can understand. How do we do that? Well, I mean, most of you will know we use brain-computer interfaces. And just to give you an idea how we, in my lab, define it. So we have a human interacting with a machine, and then this their signal stimulus perceived by the human, which is creating a brain response. This is then derived into features. So we derive features from that. So the part of the data which is recorded with, let's say, an EEG or something, that is relevant for the interaction. And that is then translated into a command that is changing the state of the machine. And we have a closed loop system here as well. So that's the definition I go with when I speak about BCIs. It's closed loop. Okay, but how do we get this running? We have to calibrate the machine. So let's assume we want to do a BCI that is reacting to your imagination of a movement. So you could imagine a left-hand movement or a right-hand movement and with your hand, not executing it, but just imagining it. Can you please do that? Can you please close your eyes and sit there and relax and try to imagine forming a fist with your left hand? And do not only visually perceive that, but also feel the muscles, how the skin would stretch. Try to perceive this as good as best as you can. And now switch to the right hand. Do not move anything, just imagine it. And now one time go to the left hand. So when you do that, your brain is creating a signal. It's a preparation for movement, basically, and it looks different. The signal when you think about your left hand and your right hand. You might have perceived that it's difficult to switch from one hand to the other hand. And so you need some training to really do that quickly. And that usually takes, depending on the state you're looking at, a couple of minutes. And then we need to generate data to calibrate the BCI. What does it mean? So we need to have prototypes, certain variants of the brain data that is associated to your right-hand movement imagination or to your left-hand movement imagination. And that usually, it can go quick, takes 10 minutes, but it can go up to 45 minutes. When we have done that, then the BCI is calibrated and you can use the signal you created to communicate with the machine. And the times here are just estimates, but this is roughly what it takes. And of course, how do we get the data? I was talking already about EEG, but we have also invasive measurements. Here you see a chip that is implanted into your brain itself, into the cortex. It's really small. And you, of course, you have to open the skull, go through the dura, and then you punch it into the brain, and then it stays there. And the benefit of that is it's really a very good signal. So you record data directly from the neurons. And the problem is it's very localized. So when Elon Musk is using Neuralink's machines to implant something to your head, you go to a certain area of your brain. And it's really localized because it doesn't want to be disturbed by other signals around it. And you can get one signal very precisely and very accurately, but you do not see what's happening in other parts of the cortex. Here you see Neuralink, and you see it's going through the skull, it's fixated there, and then going into the cortex. A non-invasive measurement means you do not harm the person, you don't go through the skin to the skull. Could be a non-invasive, an fMRI, where you go into this tube and the blood oxygenation is measured. So when your brain is working, it consumes blood from oxygen from the blood. And with an fMRI, you can measure the blood oxygenation, and you see after the brain worked, there the blood oxygenation went down. And it knows where, a couple of seconds later, it knows where something happened. You can also do that mobily with a NIRS device, where lasers are shot into your head, not harming you, but and reflect also the blood oxygenation. But the most common used technology is EEG, where we look at the electrical activity of the brain. You see an old EEG cap where you have 64 cap electrodes on the head, a little bit more modern, but basically the same thing. But there are also dry electrodes out there, so all these electrodes here need gel. So the electrode tip needs to be connected to the skin of your head, to your scalp, and to collect the electrical activity. And here they use pressure to bring the electrodes to the skin, and it can record data without gel. But in future, we might go for more simple versions of electrodes. Here you see some electrodes put into the ear, and we also have a company here that is creating these devices. And I think that's a really important part, that you have easier to use electrodes, simply to apply, not that cumbersome, and something you would like to go out with. I don't know if you would like to go out like this on the street, probably not. Yeah, and when we go into the history of BCI research, it was firstly defined in 1973. Who knows that it's that old, that it's really 50 years old? Did anybody know that? Did you know that BCI is already 50 years old? Yeah, they were defined firstly in 1973 by Jacques Vidal. And that's quite long, right? Today we see it as a new technology. And he had really many ideas in his mind. When you look at the paper, you see that it's direct control, it's user state measurement, and whatever. He was really quite creative with that. So with that, he defined the term BCI. And then there was a significant thing happening in the early 2000s, starting in the mid-80s to the early 2000s, where John Walpole and others defined BCIs as a tool to support people who are severely disabled. So people who lost control over their body but are still conscious could communicate with a BCI to the outside world. And that was narrowing down the idea of BCIs, so that you can only use it for direct control, mostly for people with disabilities. And with that, BCIs were identified with this application. That's quite interesting. So there was a broad idea in the beginning that narrowed down. And here you see a picture from the first paper published in Nature about BCIs. It was from Niels Birbaumer. And there, a patient who lost control over his body could write a letter and by using a BCI. This BCI was not machine learning based, so he really trained himself to generate a certain potential on the center of his head. So it took months for this person to do that. While he was still able to communicate to the outside world, he was trained to increase the electrical activity on the center of his head. I mean, how would you do that? If I would ask you, please create a negativity here or positivity, you wouldn't know, right? So he tried and tried and tried, and before he was completely locked in, because he lost before he lost the control of his body, he was able to change this polarity there and steer cursor to the left and right and select symbols and write a letter that was printed in Nature then. But even more prominently discussed is the so-called P300 speller. It's also about typing. I mean, of course, if people lost their communication means, you want to have something where they can say at least what's happening with them, if they have pain, if they are hungry or whatever. And the idea here is that you look at a certain letter in this matrix of symbols. Let's say you want to type the letter O, and you look at it, and then the columns and rows are flashing up randomly. And when the letter flashes up, you're looking at, you get a P300 response in your brain, and the system knows, he's looking at this column and this row, and in the end, he's looking at this, or she's looking at this this letter itself. So,
hmm?
Yeah, so that's a good question. That is very much, much dependent on eye movements. And I ask myself, you know, when I went to my first BCI conference in 2006, and 90% of the papers were about that. And I ask myself, this is not working with the patient. And I think that is, if I would criticize the field, that is the biggest problem. They were, all of them were telling, we want to help the patients, and then they worked on something which probably will not help patients. But it's not that black and white. So there are some people who control their eyes to some degree, or can have peripheral vision or something like that, and then type with that. But there are papers from 2012, I think, where they investigated how these people could use an eye tracker, and that was way better than a BCI. So it's quite interesting. This field is focusing, at least they tell, on helping patients, and the main thing they're doing is not helping patients at all. But of course, we learned a lot from that. I mean, it was fascinating to see that. And so here is a video where you see how these flashes look like. And if you look at the H, I can't see it, but so then the system would realize that and type an H and realize that you looked at that. But in the early 2000s, something changed. Machine learning came to the field. So the idea was that you don't have to train yourself to generate the signal at the spot of your hand, but that you just do it like you would like to do it, that the machine is finding itself the data it needs. So it's a calibration problem. You give some prototypes of your left hand movement, right hand movement, and then the BCI learns by itself to identify it from your data. That was cool because it was easier to use, but it also had a big change on the BCI field that it was more interdisciplinary. Until then, there were mostly people from medicine, neuroscience, and maybe psychology. And now engineers, computer scientists, mathematicians were entering the field and brought in new ideas. And this is where I entered the field and came up with the idea of passive BCIs. I will tell, yep.
Can you recall some of these early classical machine learning techniques that they used?
What it's basically the same now. So it's the problem is that we really do not have much data. So what we do is we have 80 trials for each class, so we have 160 trials or something like that, and you can't go with any complex machine learning algorithm there. So I think they started with an LDA or SVM as a classifier, and then, but that's also not the problem. The biggest deal is the feature extraction. So how do you find the proper data? Because interestingly, in now my 25 years of work in that field, I saw that if there's a signal, it is normally distributed. So if you do it well and you get the data, it's normally distributed, and then the linear classifier is the best thing you can do. So you don't need any nonlinear or deep learning from that perspective. You know, it is already the optimal classifier for that. But the problem is in generating the signal in the brain. So how do I, you know, people try now to classify happiness. And when I say from sadness, like I said, and when I say I need 80 trials, I would need to make you 80 times happy and then 80 times sad, and then mix it up because it should not be in a block. So that's not easy, right? How do you do that? How do I ensure that the person who is calibrating the system right now is 80 times for 5 seconds happy and for 5 seconds sad? It's really not working out. So emotion detection is really difficult. With hand movements, imagination, that's quite easy. Yeah? But yeah, that being said, it's the generation of the signal in the head is a problem. And then extracting the features that reflect these states is the second problem, but classification itself is done by linear classifier usually.
Just to follow up on that.
Yeah.
This is for discrete classes. What about the continuous evolution of states? Was that also introduced in the
90s? No, it was not. It was really just binary classes, if not even. You know, if you look at workload, you would like to only know whether you have high workload or low workload. You want to know how high is your workload, 70%, 60% or whatever. No, that was not introduced at all. It was really focusing only on two discrete classes, and that's it. Yes, exactly that. Or blink or not blink when you are, so the letter flashed up or not. And I came up with the, a little story on that. And like I said, I was in 2006, I was the first time at a conference in Graz. And I was a young PhD student and saw two professors talking. And one was talking about the motor battery BCI and the other one about the P300 speller. And they got into an argument. And the reason for that was both were referring to a BCI, and they were not aware that the other one was talking about a different system. From a user's perspective, using a P300 speller is totally different than a motor battery. And they really... what I just showed here, this is a P300 speller where it flashed up, and the other one is imagining your hand movements. So what we did before. You can move a cursor to the left or right by imagining your left and right hand movement. So both were used to spell words. And here you just, you used your eyes, but they didn't speak about that, but you were reacting to a flashing letter, and then the system knows he's looking at the O or whatever. And with the other one, you would steer a cursor to the left or right, and you have all the letters on a string, and then you can select it. And there's a huge difference from the user's perspective how to use these systems. And I thought we have to give that a name. And from the user's perspective, the motor battery BCI is an active BCI. So where you actively, if you take the user's perspective, the user is deciding to send out a command by himself or herself. So I decide now to think about my left hand movement. I'm fully in control. With a P300 speller, I'm not. I can look at the H on the matrix or letters, but I have to wait until the system flashes up, this letter up. So I'm dependent on the system to do something. So I'm reacting to something. So this is why I call that reactive BCIs. Do you have a question on that?
No, I'm
going to
just
think about it. Okay. No, but you know, it was really strongly discussed because this user's perspective was quite uncommon at that time in the field. But you know, there's something left. When I am stressed out, you can see that in my brain activity, even though I do not communicate that actively. Or if I see an error happening, even before I realize myself, there's a signal in my brain telling that's wrong. And why don't we utilize that system as well, that data as well? And this is what I call passive BCIs. So the idea here is that you work with the computer and the system is tracking your mental state and changes your mental state and is learning from that how you interpret the world, basically. And that paper was published in 2011. And that's the reason why I'm here today, because Alex found that paper, which had a quite huge impact on the BCI field. What does impact mean? It was quite interesting to see that. It was really the first time in 2008 when I presented it, two years later after my first conference. I saw the audience, and there were a couple of hundred people, and half of them were cheering and saying, great, that's cool, finally a good definition and something new. And the other part of the crowd was really angry. They looked at me, well, why do you do that? Because they were so focused on helping people with disabilities that they thought opening up to other people, opening up to other applications, would take money away and would make it more difficult. And then it took really long discussions over 4 years or even 5 years until finally the leader of the field, John Warpaw, changed the definition of BCIs, including now also passive BCIs, which is quite cool. And from that on, it entered the field of human-computer interaction. I think today there are over 150 labs working on passive BCIs in the world. And we're focusing now more not on the detection of the signal and optimizing the machine learning, but on something we can do with it. How can we build tech that works with passive BCIs? So if we have, to some accuracy, information about your workload, how do we integrate that into your car or into your computer, that it works better in the end? So what do we do with that? If we have access to that information, how do we create systems that are really working better in the end? And that's led to the definition of a new field. We discussed it yesterday, the field of new adaptive technology, which I'm leading since 2017. And that's focusing more on integrating passive BCIs into technology. Okay, and I discussed with you already that we do something like direct control, where we replace button presses with, let's say, motometric control on the P300 Speller. We can also do something which I call implicit control, where the system is tracking my state and sees, oh, his workload is going up, I have to change something. Imagine you're driving down a highway with your car and you turned off the autopilot, everything's fine, and suddenly there's an accident. And you have to react quickly. And you really are not, you don't know what to do. It's you have 2 seconds to react and you don't know what to do. Then you do not have time to turn on the autopilot or ask the car, hey, please help me. But if it recognizes that you lost control, it could turn on automatically the autopilot and help you with that. Or another example is look on your phone. You type something, there's an autocorrect, and the autocorrect is wrong. It's not the word you wanted to type. The system would see an error response even before you get aware of it, before it gets to your consciousness, and could correct the error automatically. So with that, we change the way how we interact with machines in a drastic way. So now we have ideas, concepts, and intentions, and we have to translate that through manual input into the language of the machine. If I say, do something, I have to type it in on my keyboard, word letter by letter. But with passive PCIs, the system is observing you and the context, and it's understanding how you are reacting to the context. And with that, it can adapt itself automatically to your needs. And one important thing is that usually we have a direct reaction. So if my workload goes high, the system is reacting to it. And then the system starts over again. But it's, of course, when you look at the PCI literature, passive PCI literature, 95% of the applications do exactly that. There's a change in the user state, the system is reacting on it, and then it starts over. But it's the more intelligent way to use it is to create a user model, to learn how do we react to the world. If I'm waking up in the morning and my screen is blue and I don't like that, I get an error response and the system could realize, oh, Thorsten doesn't like blue screens in the morning, but I like it maybe in the evening. So the system is over time, when I use it over time, creating a model about my consciousness and learning about what I like, what I don't like, what my values are, whatever. Yeah.
How do you see that happen initially as part of the calibration stage versus then it actually being applied more widely? One, and two, how far off are we? What are the key blockers for us being able to utilize this technology, for example, to get a car to stop?
Yeah. So I will get there in the talk later, but I can give you an answer right now so it's very simple. We have a lot of applications in the lab, in the drawer. We've used it in lab scenarios, but not in the outside world. And the reason why is because we are missing easy-to-use sensors, easy-to-apply sensors that provide still good data. You know, that's important. And the calibration is a huge problem. So, EEG, so... You have seen the caps, right? And if you put one of these caps with 64 electrodes on your head, it takes an expert who's standing next to you half an hour. And you wear this fancy cap on your head and you have gel in your hair, and that is not what people would like to do when they want to drive a car or something like that. And also, you need an expert to do that. To do it yourself is really, it's possible, I can do it now myself, but it's difficult. And so we need something, like I mentioned earlier, you can plug into your ear, I've shown the picture, or something you can apply yourself. And for another example, we were working with Airbus, the aerospace company. And we had pilots, and they did the first experiment, they liked that. And the second experiment, we changed the room in the building. And when they had to go to the restroom, they had to walk down the stairs. And they refused to do that with a cap on their head, because they thought, people think I'm sick. People think I have a mental problem or I have a medical problem. They didn't want to wear the cap because their colleagues might think something wrong with them. And we had to stop the experiment. They really refused to continue with that. And then, yeah. No, no, please, 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 yeah. Yeah, that's okay. I'm a little bit slow, obviously, with my presentation because you already asked the right questions. So now it will come later in a little more detail. But yeah, so this is a problem as well. Currently, we use it in the lab mostly, and then we have context information available. So we take the information on the screen, or we have cameras in the lab or whatever. And that's the second problem. When you leave the lab, how do you get the context information? I fully agree. And so this is a limiting factor. So you have to take that into account if you create an application, that context data is critically important. When you see I'm surprised, so there's a surprise signal in my head, but you don't know why I'm surprised. What is this information telling you? Nothing. A little bit, but not what you want to know. But let's imagine, this is just a theoretical thought. You know, this is not what we do at the moment, but let's imagine you have context assessment available in your room and you're wearing a cap which is integrated into your daily life. Then the system can learn about you and adapt itself to it and create a model about you. And there's a second talk I give tonight at 5:30. There we present one model and show you how that really could work. And specifically when we're talking about AIs, it is now the last step in the theoretical part, we can talk about cognitive probing. The idea of cognitive probing is basically that the system wants to acquire information. It has a model of you and it's missing what color do you like. It doesn't know that. So it can implicitly get that information from you by integrating a question into your daily routine. So it could just decide to change the color of your screen and see how you react to that. So the system is in a state and it knows something, it wants to know something. It decides to integrate a probe stimulus that is influencing your user state. It measures the biosignal, is aggregating it with the context, extracts information, adds it to the user model, and that changes the system state. And you see only this part is visible to the user. So all of that is going blindly to the user. Okay, I will not answer that question now because that you will see in the afternoon session. Otherwise, it's not that interesting anymore. But so much about the theories. Sorry for bombarding you with that, but I think it's important to really understand the history of what happened there, because I realized here when I talked to people that most people didn't know the term passive BCI, which is okay, but most people were also thinking about only direct control. And you can do so much more with the BCI, not only direct control. But you can do direct control, and I will show you some examples of what has been done and also draw a conclusion from that. So let's start with the example motor memory BCI, active BCI. So, how do we want to assess the brain activity is the first question. What kind of, if you want to set up a system, what kind of signal are we expecting? How do we get to that information? How do we train the machine to recognize it automatically later on? And this is the last point, but the most important point, how can we design an application that is using that properly? So we want to do motor memory control, what you did before. When you move moving your right hand, this part of the brain, the red part, is activated. That's your motor cortex. It's contralateral, so if you do something with your right side, it's the left part of the brain and vice versa. And you see this area is doing everything, most of the things, when you're moving. That's quite interesting, right? That's the part that makes you move. And here you see a schematic description of that, where the body is stretched over this part of the red area, and you see which part of that red area is relevant for each body part. And you see that your mouth and tongue and your hand get a quite big part, because there you do the most fine-grained movements. So you need a lot of neurons to do the fine finger movements you do. And so we are looking at this one when we think about this part of the EG, of the brain activity, when we think about motor memory control. And when you put a cap on the head of somebody, you put electrodes on top of the head. This is a nose. It's a top view of the head. And you see how the electrodes are distributed over the head. These are 128 electrodes. And all of them have a name. So, and we have a system that I can put it on, you can put it on your head, and it is always referring to the basically the same area of the head. Yeah.
So, you have to be able to correctly detect the right signal for the right thing and place it within specific context. But for example, I know that sometimes I could be driving and I'm focused on driving, but I'm also thinking about something else.
Absolutely.
And so I like my brain could be reacting to something else that isn't necessarily to do with driving. So how do you identify and distinguish one from the other?
Yeah, that is the biggest problem. And this is the simple answer is machine learning. So what we do is we have an overlay not only of these two things, but of millions of things going on in your brain. You have trillions of neurons. All of them are working. So this myth that we only use 10% of our brain is totally rubbish. We use all of our brain, our neurons are active all the time, and we have to distinguish those neurons or those neural activities that are relevant for our task. What we do is we collect examples, like I said, the prototypes, and then the system is looking for similarities between the movements when you calibrate the system. So when you think 5 of the 80 times thinking about your left hand, you might think about dinner tonight and or other things, and these cancel out in the end. So these are not in each trial. So it looks for the most common signal in each part.
Our commonality is that common, though, because for example, I know that even like my brain, what it looks like now versus what it looks like in an hour is completely different. So to what extent can you actually identify common themes?
Yeah. So another great question. So the thing is, we don't know, we can't tell how long a system, once it's calibrated, is running, as it's working well. So, but what we can tell is, as soon as you put the cap on, you have to recalibrate. If it's a different person, you have to recalibrate. And that's also the big problem with calibration I mentioned earlier. I will speak to this afternoon about something I call universal classifiers, which is solving that problem. And that is rather new, and that is... so. The big bottlenecks we have is electrodes and calibration time. And I will present solutions for that we have developed in my company tonight. And that is opening up the barrier or the bottleneck that hindered BCIs to come to the world. I think with that technology, when we have new electrodes and new calibrations, we will see a lot of new applications coming to the real world within the next 5 years. Because these are the problems hindering the tech to come real. So what you do here, you measure the electrical potential to a reference electrode, which is not collecting brain activity, but let's say it's on your nose or somewhere else where no brain activity is available. And then you look at the difference, and this is reflecting your brain activity at that spot. You can go up to 256 electrodes. Here you see 128, usually 64 enough. And here you see electrode C3 and C4, which are reflecting the left and right part of your cortex, of your motor cortex. So when we think about left-hand movement, it's on the right hemisphere, and this is how the data would look like when you record data from that electrode. This is a time series. You have microvolts here and time here, there, and you see the fluctuation in milliseconds over time.
You mentioned that 64 electrodes are usually enough. What do you think about that?
So when you imagine that you only take half of these electrodes you see, or a quarter of that, it's still, you can distribute it all over the head, and you get a lot of information from the brain itself, so from the complete brain itself. It's different than with the invasive electrodes we've seen before, where we really go only to one certain spot, but with these electrodes you get the full information of signals emitted from the brain. And of course, it's more precise if you have a higher density of these electrodes. But generally said, rule of thumb, it's enough if you have 64 electrodes to get a good resolution of the signal itself.
So then what do you think about the extreme case, like Anglion, you know, ultra,
yeah.
ultra ultra high density detox that you can, place around the motor areas and have 1,000 electrodes just in the motor area. You think we're going to see some nice results there?
So with invasive methods, I do not know. I don't know. I have to plainly say I do not know. But there is a limit on the outer, if you take EEG on, not invasively, because it's too much redundancy. If you lose an electrode, the other one can jump in. But if it's properly connected, you do not get much more information when you have more than 96 electrodes or something like that. No, so you have to see like a if you have a certain patch of neurons active, and they emit a signal that is like a dipole emitting a projection of electrical fields to the scalp, and they have usually a size of this or something, and then if you have an electrode in there, you get it, and if you have a second electrode in there, you don't get much more information about that. That's basically the granularity of the signal you can get at the scalp. If you're on the brain, of course, you get more information, more fungal information, so I think that it makes sense to have more sensors, but on the scalp, it doesn't make any sense.
There are some electrodes that have few millimeters of diameter.
Yeah.
Do you think that these are fundamentally changing?
No, I do not, because I think if you are in this protection, when you are on the projection field in the area where the dipole is projecting to, one electrode is enough. And you usually get them if you have 64 electrodes. It's really close by enough to get the signal. I think this is more like marketing to increase the electrodes on the skull, but it will not improve it much. I mean, we see the opposite. The company Iden or others are using only one or two electrodes in the ear and try to solve the problem with that. I think that's the opposite. That is maybe a little bit too, not enough. Yeah, but this is a problem we need to solve, right? I mean, how many electrodes can we use comfortably, and how good is the signal we get there? But one thing I forgot to mention earlier is really important. Everybody's speaking always about invasive methods are better, and that's not true. They are on the spot; they are better. They get a better signal, but they only get that signal on that spot. If you want to use a passive PCI on a healthy person, you might want to get different types of signals, and not only on a certain spot. So then the non-invasive method is way better because you get the full, complete picture of the brain. It's of course more noisy, but it's.
And then, sorry, just the last follow-up. It's still me.
No, of course.
It's about. Because we're having a kind of a deep dive on the electrode placement, the number of electrodes, but I also wonder what's your perspective on, using dry electrodes, wet electrodes, the semi-wet electrodes.
Yeah.
Can you talk about
Absolutely.
That in the case of passive BCIs?
Yeah. So I wrote a lot of papers on dry electrodes because I was really convinced that it might be the solution, but I have to step back from that. So. In the lab, it works well. You can really show that you get good data from dry electrodes, and it's comparably good to the gel electrodes. It's really nice. But there are two problems. Like I said earlier, it's solved by pressure. So you have to really have a stronger pressure that the electrodes stay on the spot. And that causes headaches after 10 to 35 minutes. We have statistics about that, but everybody gets headaches after a while. That's a huge problem. And the second thing is, if you move around, the electrodes move slightly and scratch on the skin. And that is creating artifacts you can't get rid of. So when you have a gel bed where it's in, it moves, and you get a soft artifact. You can get rid of with artifact reduction methods. But that means with dry electrodes, if you walk around, half of your data is gone because you have scratching artifacts there. And that's an inherent problem. You can't solve that. If you have semi-dry electrodes, with a solid gel or something like that, that's a better solution. But also there you have scratch artifacts. And it really depends on the use case. But I would not go for something real with dry electrodes.
Thank you. then you have to assume that people are going to be have to applying all of the gels in order to use it at every session.
Yeah.
I mean, that's just as a consumer nightmare right there, you know, for everything that they try to do. I don't want to wash my hair every time I use a BCI.
Absolutely. So, I fully agree. And that is what I referred to earlier as a bottleneck, why it's not hitting the street right now, why it's not coming to the real world. But again, I'm referring to the lecture, to the talk later tonight. It's only 5:30. Yes. But you had a question too, right? Alex?
I think you touched on it a bit earlier on the noise part, but have you considered collecting a lot of noisy data and seeing if like we talk about noise with EEG as something to be discarded? And I wonder if that's because there's just not enough time to actually explore this amount of variance that happens, right? Like, because there should still be some signal in that there's an artifact, but there should still be something, right? Or isn't there anything?
Well, we have to go a little bit more into detail about that. There are different types of artifacts. So there are bodily artifacts. Like my eyes are dipoles when I move around with my eyes. So I look around in this room. It's a dipole changing, and you have an electrical field submitting to the electrodes.
Yeah.
If I use my muscles, they create a larger, stronger electrical field than my brain does. Then I have movement artifacts. So like when the electrode is moving on my head or the cable is moving around, I have artifacts. There is electrical field in this room which is changing, which is modulating, that's affecting the electrodes. So, and you're right. And there are, the last part of artifacts is other brain signals we don't want to look at, right? I'm talking to you now, and I might think about my cat, which is at home alone, and that might distract my brain signals, right? And you're right, part of these signals are probably relevant, and specifically if you go into a use case where you're looking for a lot of data, then maybe the AI that is building a model of my consciousness would like to know that I think about my cat right now, right? Then it's not an artifact. It's maybe for the main purpose, like talking to you, is he stressed out or not? It's not relevant, but from another perspective, it is relevant. So it really becomes complicated there. But there are definitely artifacts which you want to get rid of. And these are really meaningless artifacts. Like when the electrode moves and you get a scratch artifact, you don't want to have that. There's no information. Well, you could say you can deduce my head movement from that. You know that. But you can easier do that with an accelerometer on my electrode. So that's you wouldn't do that with the EEG electrodes. But you know, I agree. We're a little bit too strong with the term artifact. Something is maybe not relevant information at the moment, but maybe later on. But parts of them, the artifacts are really not good.
Thank you.
Sure. Yeah, so here you see how you do this gelling. You see a ring here, it's an old electrode. You put some gel in, and then you take a cut tip and distribute it through the hair. And on the screen, you see green and red dots. And if it's red, it's not well connected. And if it's green, it's well connected. OK. But you know, let's go back to the topic. We want to go for motor memory BCI. Well, I could also ask you, do you want to see the details about that? So, I can also skip that if it's not that relevant for you, because we're running. Yeah. Yeah, well, I mean, what I wanted to do now is go to a little bit to the signal processing. But I think I'm going to skip that here. So you can do some machine learning where you then derive the signal from and train a classifier, but that's simple machine learning, which probably most of you know. But let's assume we have calibrated a BCI. So what we did is we did a sequence of R's and L's on the screen, where an R indicated to imagine right-hand movement and an L and left-hand movement. You did that 80 times. We collected the data. We calibrated the BCI. And now let's get to the task. It's a simple task called the basket paradigm, introduced in 2003 by the group in Graz. And now you will see data from 2005 I collected in my own lab. And the task is to control this ball, which is falling down from the center top of the screen, to the blue basket, which might be on the left-hand side or right-hand side of the screen. And you do that by imagining your hand movements, which you have seen earlier. Now, a little story. 2005, I gave the first class on BCIs ever. And that was actually the first lecture series ever on BCIs, which I wasn't aware at the time, but I realized later. And there was a student sitting in my class. And Antje is her name, German name. And she said, very interesting, but I don't believe that works. You tell us interesting thing that might work one day, but it's not working out. I just started my position there, so we had to set up a lab, and I promised Antje, we're going to do an experiment at the end of the semester with you. And you see now the video where she's doing that for the first time. So she did this procedure, she calibrated the BCI, and is now doing the basket paradigm. And here you see the ball, and the number on the top left is 24 hits and 3 misses. So she missed the basket 3 times. And you see that is real control. She's doing that by imagining her left or right in movement, and the ball is going to the direction where he wants to do that. And she's not moving at all, and she's doing that for the first time. And you get an idea about the granularity of the system, how well it works. And she was, I think, 84 times from 100 times she hit the basket, and 16 times she missed the basket. And quite interestingly, 16 years later, there was a huge response to a YouTube video, which was released by Neuralink, Elon Musk, and which is basically the same thing. It's done by a monkey, and it's with invasive electrodes, and he's playing Pong, which is basically the same thing, going up and down instead of left and right. And it was really interesting for me to see that, specifically the reactions on the screen, on the YouTube, where people said, imagine a person could do that. How would the world look like if you could do that? And I mean, 15 years earlier, he did that in our labs, and even earlier in Graz. And that's quite interesting, which also tells something about us in Europe, that we're not good at marketing, and that we're not really good at bringing something out to the world. Of course, it's great now to see that with Neuralink, there's so much attention on this, but it was also quite a little bit frustrating. And now let's go to a little more interesting example, flying a plane, a flight simulator, where we actually did the same thing. So the idea here was a group in Munich, south of Germany, asked me in Berlin, can we control a plane? They wanted to do that for fun. They thought that might be a cool application. And I'm not a fan of flying planes with a BCI because I know how well it works. But I was curious to see whether that makes a difference. If I'm honest, and you know, you have seen the basket paradigm, if you sit there, after 5 minutes, you get bored, right? And you do that, it's fun, but then 100 balls, I have to do that, really? And that is, of course, biasing the results. And when you look at the results in the papers, it's always like that. People sit there for an hour doing the same simple task, nobody cares about that. And I wanted to know, does it make a difference if I do the same thing? I just control the flight stick to the left and right with motor memory control, and do we get better results? So that's from 2014, 10 years ago. And here you see the movements you could bring to the flight stick by imagining left and right hand movements. That's just based on brain signals. And we invited pilots who are professionally flying planes from the military or Lufthansa. And we let them do training tasks, which they would do to get their license. And you see the inside of the plane. It's a simulator, of course. They're wearing a cap, and now they're doing a heading bug task. They have to go to a certain direction, stay there for a while, and then go to the next direction. And this person is also doing that for the first time. We explain it to him, and now the difficult part comes. They are flying over the clouds, and they have to land on the landing strip. And what we do is we manipulated the controls, or the feedback, and they would penetrate the clouds, being offset by 200 meters to the left. And here you see what they saw, and here you see the brain response. And they had to bring a line, these green lines here, to bring them on track. And when they would pop through the clouds, they would see they're offset, and they have to react on that quickly and fix the problem they have. And we wanted to know, can they do that? So, they oscillate a bit, you see that. But that's a problem of the implementation. So now they're above the clouds, and they will pop through the clouds and then see that on the right-hand side, there is a landing strip. So he's offset, and now he needs to get there. And you see the landing, the flight stick, how it controls that. And I was fascinated to see that. To be honest, I don't want to sit in that plane, clearly not. But to see how well he could do that, how fine-grained he could fly the plane and steer it towards a landing strip was fascinating to me. When you think about this, when you look at the literature in the world, they say you have an 84% accuracy over 2,000 people doing a motor imagery. And to see that in the real world, more realistic world, was really interesting. And let's see, you know, like I said, I don't want to sit in the plane, but he's approaching the landing strip. And let's see whether he can bring the plane down. Yeah, we don't want to sit in there. But from a BCI researcher's perspective, that was fascinating to see. And in the end, there is almost a touchdown. So, and when you look at the results, you see very proper brain signals, if you know how to read that. But what's maybe more interesting is that the blue line would be the optimal path, and the green line is what they flew. And you see they're quite close to that. And the fun part is, let me see, we had a 98% of accuracy, which is 15%, it's almost perfect, it's not good enough, even for real world. But they really had sweat on the forehead, they really took it seriously, and they had fun with it, and that changed the accuracy dramatically. So this gives some evidence it is better than we think. You can also combine it with eye tracking, and the idea basically there is, that's a question, sorry. So this is, I skipped that earlier where we did the signal processing where I went through, but it's motor desynchronization. So you have a 10 hertz activity on the left or right hand cortex, motor cortex, and that is going down when you use that side. Imagining left and right hand movements. Yeah, what we did before, yeah. So, and you can combine it with eye tracking, and then with an eye tracker, you can steer a cursor, but when you want to select something, you don't have a natural command in there. Yeah, sorry. No. So I know that some people do that and we can't collect the signal because that's a folding of the cortex, which is not projecting into the electrodes. But so far I haven't seen anybody, there were more problems, but everybody did it in the end. They don't have what?
So there's people that have this like condition where it's almost like there's no, like they don't have a thought, like a voice in their head that they used to kind of guide their thoughts.
Mm-hmm.
I wonder how this applies in those contexts.
That's hard to say. I don't have any experience with that. But I mean, the thing is, if they can use their brain in a way that they are aware of it,
mm-hmm.
they should emit the similar signal, I think. Yeah. But if you're looking for inner speech, maybe probably not. But that's I don't have any experience with that. Of course, there are a lot of conditions people might have which might affect the BCI.
Yeah.
But I was mostly working with healthy people, with people without disabilities. Yeah.
What are the use cases?
Like, what are the use cases you think? You know, like you're familiar with that are already working in real life, besides like flying and simulator.
Yeah. So I will skip now the eye tracking part because it's too long. But you can, the simple thing I want to say is you can control a cursor on the screen with your eye tracking, but with your eye movements, and then the cursor is going there, but you can't click. But you can replace the clicking with a automatic thought. You can think about wringing out a towel, and then you can click like with the mouse. You can replace a mouse with eye movements and so on. But let's skip through that. Just look at the video, not the details. So he has to find the BPDL here, which is there. So he moves the eye, the cursor there, and then he creates a brain signal to select it, and it was correct. PSRL is here, he moves his eyes there, creates a signal, and is selecting it. is how it could work in the end. So, and that's great. It's fascinating. You can communicate through the with the BCI to a machine, and you can do task completion with that. But the problem is it requires full focus. It really is stressful when you talk to the pilots of the plane. They were really stressed out after that. Mm-hmm. It's slow and unreliable. So you can create a signal every half a second or maybe 1 second, which is reliably detected. And reliably means something about, if you're lucky, you're 99%, but you don't want to drive a car with 99% of accuracy. I mean, every 100th turn, you go to the wrong direction. You don't want that, right? So I think, and that's a strong statement, all of that is only applicable for patients. People who lost their control of the body, they should use it. It's great to do that, but if you're thinking about real-world applications for people without disabilities, don't go for direct control. If you can use your hand, use your hand. If you can use any kind of muscle in your body, use that muscle. It's only for those people who lost complete control over the body, and that's it. And stop doing it. Stop doing research for people who are not completely locked in. That's a waste of your time if you're aiming at realistic applications. And I'm telling this now for 15 years and still no change. People do not listen to me, I see that. But I hope that people understand that they don't listen to me, that this is a wrong way. Like, I mean, like you mentioned earlier, when you want to type something, a P3 guidance speller, use an eye tracker. Don't use a BCI for that. But still today, it's not 95% anymore, but 78% of the research is done on P3 guidance spellers. Why is that? It's not because you want to create applications, not bring it to the real world. You will not do that. What you can do is do passive PCIs for implicit control. Okay. With that, I envision a communication that is more natural, because the machine is understanding empathically what you want to do and is supporting you in that way. So we want to have less effort in translation, implicit communication. It should be user adaptive, context sensitive, socially acceptable, and you want to have some kind of empathy. Okay, this is a list of words, and we will now go through that and understand what that means. So I will now give you proof of concept that all of this can be done with a passive PCI. But firstly, let's start with a thought experiment that you get an idea what I mean with passive PCIs. Let's do a thought experiment, haha, pun intended. So let's go for a music recommendation system. So we know how machine learning works. Let's assume we have a lot of data on different types of music and how they relate to each other and what people like. If they listen to one band, do they like another band? Then we have a person, we have located their preferences in this data we have, and we want to build up a music recommendation system that we can suggest them more types, different type of music they like. And let's assume our system identifies two bands, which are the Rolling Stones, you might know, and Richard Kleidermann, you might not know, but it's a cheesy piano player, very different type of music. And the system knows you like both of that. But when you come home at one certain evening, it's really dependent on your mood, what you would like to hear. If you are more energized, you would like to listen to Rolling Stones. If you're a little bit more relaxed, you might listen to Richard Kleidermann. And what is it? What is it? The system, if you go for a big data analysis, it's not included in that data. How would the system know what you would like to hear? So I recommend to put a cap on your head, and then it tells you you're in a relaxed mood, and the system would know what to do. Yeah. Of course, that is a thought experiment. It's not a real thing, but of course you need to do something like that. You need to see. So the first question you need to answer is what of your mind state is telling me whether you want to listen to one type of music or the other type of music? And of course it would be some emotional state, I think, but also, you know, how awake you are, how stressed you are, something like that. And it would also need to learn about you personally. Maybe some people who are over-energized want to listen then to soft music to get down or to get a little more relaxed. So that is really user-dependent. A second thought example is a new adaptive book, which is a little bit different. Think about you have an e-reader, and you read the first 20 pages, and there's Peter and Paul. and you like Peter, but you don't like Paul at all. And the system is recognizing that. You respond positively to Peter, negatively to Paul. Then it could change the pages you haven't read yet in a way that the book is more interesting for you. So with that, you are writing or changing the content of the book implicitly. You're not even aware that you're doing that. And when you read the book 2 years later, you might like Paul and do not like Peter because you have learned something about life, and you read a different book. It's the same thing, but you read a different book and you rewrote it implicitly. And why can we do that? Because we have a real-time state detection with passive BCI. So we have responses of the brain to the real world, and we have 100 years of EEG research, which tells us how does it look like when my workload rises? How does it look like when I have emotions in my How does it look like when I interpret something? Is it correct or incorrect? How does it look like when I have a context-related response? Oh, I'm surprised to see that. How does it look like if I have intentions? And all of that is available in the literature. We just need to translate that into BCIs, and we can get all that information and interpret that in the context and change the system. Let's start with workload adaptive interfaces. So workload is really quite relevant for many systems. If I'm learning a new language, I don't want to be overloaded all the time. It's difficult for me. I don't want to be underloaded, or many other examples. And we created a paradigm, which is the most relevant and complicated part in BCI research, which is creating workload in your head in a controlled fashion. And we have an accuracy of 85% on 1 second of data. So what we distinguish is high workload against low workload, and the system can do that with 85% if you get them 1 second of data. It's a guess. If you give them 10 seconds of data, it goes up to 98%. But that, of course, requires that your workload is constant over that, roughly in the same area, over 10 seconds. And here you see an example we did in my lab where this person is looking on the screen. And what she sees is sparkles, we call it, so points moving around. This was an idea that this is reflecting something's happening out in the outside world you look at, and you're not bored about that. But then a task appears. It's a repetitive task. It's a three-digit number, and you have to repetitively subtract a two-digit number from that. So 398 minus 12, minus 12, minus 12, minus 12. That is, of course, creating some workload. And then you do not want to be distracted by the sparkles on the screen. You want to focus on the numbers on the screen. And here you see how the system adapts. You see the sparkles flying around. She might ask herself, what's going on here? So there is some modulation in her workload. So they might disappear, but then they come back. And now the numbers appear, and she's doing the calculation, and the sparkles disappear. So the system only knows her brain state, adapting the numbers of sparkles inversely to her workload. And you see that this works really well. That's an example of workload adaptive interface. We used that also with surgeons in the UK. So they did two tasks, a simple task, hand knot tying around a rubber artery, or to do that laparoscopically, so where they have to use 2D screen and use tools to do that. And we could detect here on 86% of accuracy whether they were doing one task or the other, again, with 1 second of data. So, okay, it's the same thing, but it really shows it works in more realistic scenarios. And we have the same signals, and it's all good. And I was invited by an artist in Berlin who created the Museum of Stillness. That's a room which is really still in the loud and crazy city of Berlin. And he wanted to have a safe space where people can go and relax and sit there and calm down, like a church, but without any religious background. But people, he created that room, he's an artist, he painted a picture and whatever, painting, and people wanted to know, he wanted to know how well does it work. So he invited me to his museum, and we, on the open night of museums, and one person was sitting in that room trying to relax, and in another room, 30 people were sitting looking at her brain data and see how well she was relaxing. So we had here again an accuracy of 80%, on a 1 second of data, whether she was relaxed or not relaxed. So the idea was that that was a painting which is in the center of the room, and to the people who were watching that, we showed that picture, and if she would be less relaxed, we would cloud it, we would move clouds in front of that that picture so that you can't see it anymore. And here you see what the people were perceiving, and here you see also the brain signal. So she was in the beginning not relaxed. See the clouds moving, that's a bit hard to see. And you see her workload was rather high, but then she managed to relax a bit and the clouds were disappearing. And people saw, wow, it's really working. And here's a little bit oscillatory because she also heard the people cheering when that happened. And there was one person coming in and it was really always clear. There was no fog, there was no nothing in front of the picture. And then I asked her, what are you doing? And she said, yeah, I'm trained in meditation. If I'm really good at that. She really could control her mind that well. What is the question?
Out there, what were you showing?
This was the workload output.
Okay.
So it would mean if it goes up, there was low workload. If it goes down, it was high workload. This was the output of the BCI, basically. So the BCI is giving a number between -1 and 1. And -1 meant low workload, high workload, and 1 meant
Same. Thank you.
And a couple of years, I was invited to a TV show in Germany. It's a late night show, and they wanted me to show a demonstration there. And the idea was, we have two people; they would play against each other, and there's a drone in the middle, and they need to relax. Both of the players need to relax, and if they relax stronger than the other person, the drone would fly to the other person. So the more you relaxed, the stronger you push the drone away. So both try that, and the stronger one is pushing the drone to the west. So you need to remain calm while the drone is flying towards you. And here's a short video of that. See the drone in the middle flying. And you see the two players. They are just, you didn't see them, but they're wearing a headband. And this one is pushing to the other one. And he's blocking that now, sending it back to the other one. And they had a fair battle in the end. But now the moderator makes a joke. He has to laugh. And he loses focus, and the drone is, now he has lost the point. Yeah. So you see the younger Thorsten here. Okay, so that shows also, when I went down the stairs, I thought, why am I doing that? It's crazy. Why do we go to show and to go to all the stress? Everything can go wrong. But it was really important for me to see that everything I tell all the time, it can work in a realistic scenario, really works out. And for me, that was the best proof of concept. Still, we have to improve things. It's still not nice enough. But it really showed me, that was 2016, 8 years ago, this is really good work out. I still have some time. Okay, good. Another state next to workload is the intention to interact. So the idea is basically, can the system understand when I'm looking at something that I want to interact with that? So if I'm looking at an icon on the screen, is there a signal that is reflecting, hey, that's interesting for me, I want to do something with that, I want to interact with that? And how does it look like when I look at it just to understand what it is? So what we did there was we designed an experimental paradigm, and let's go into one version of that. You start with a fixation cross, then you get the task, find the triangle, and then two objects appear. Here you see a circle and a triangle, and then you focus on that. If you do that for 2 seconds, it will disappear and replaced by a cross, and then it goes on like that. So you, the thing is, you have to focus for the object you need to find, you want to interact with for 2 seconds, and then you have to wait, looking at the cross, until the next session starts. And there we have the two different mind states. So here, if you look at the triangle, you want to interact with the triangle. and we look at the fixation because you're just waiting. And we compare the data with that, between that, and we see here the green, the blue curve is showing what happens when you just wait. And you see there's not much variation. And the green curve is showing when you are, so here's a point where you interact with the system. It's 1 second before that. What happens in your mind when you have the intention to interact with that system? And the purple curve is a difference curve. And you see that mostly in the back part of your head, and that's really, really quite reliable. And that was the first time that that has been shown, where you see that the intention to interact is really reflected strongly. That's really quite a strong EEG signal in your head the moment you decide to interact with that. An accuracy of 82% or 81%. And interestingly, that a group in Russia picked that up and wrote 8 papers about that. And for me, it was nice to see that they basically found exactly the same signal. It's a different kind of graph, but you see it's going up and going down. And they also have the same topography there. They replicated that in Russia. And they played several games with that and really showed that this is really applicable in the real world and that you really can detect the intention to interact quite accurately when you're interacting with the system. So, what are the conclusions of the implicit control? A machine can adapt itself to the changes in the mental state of its operator. It can detect it at the moment, and it can use that to improve its own actions. But the important question is, when we go a little bit more to the AI part, can it gain an understanding of the operator? I will go into that later on in the talk in the afternoon. But can we solve the alignment problem with that? Can it, if you create this model of a human mindset, and this model is accessible to the AI, can it gain an understanding of that person that really reflects that person's personality, the values the person has? That's totally gone away from the interaction thought I'm presenting here. And the fun part is, you can do that. And let's dive into that firstly now, with the first experiment, and in the afternoon session we go in a more direct application of that. But I promise you that we can answer these questions. So, do we have less effort in translation? Yeah, I mean, when I have to type something in, I have to focus on that. If I use an active BCI, I have to focus on that. The passive BCI just works in without your attention. You might not even be aware that you're wearing the system. You might not even be aware that the system, that the machine is assessing information about you. And that leads to implicit communication. Why is that? It's assessing information, but it's context-relevant information that is reflecting your personal interpretation of the moment. And from that, the system can derive a command which is supporting the interaction. The system can really understand your interpretation of the world in the moment where it's happening and adapt itself to that. So with that, it becomes user-adaptive. It would work on my mind differently than on your mind. It's not transferable. I mean, if you were similar people, then it might be. And now with the last experiment for today, for this session, I will speak about the other 3 points that are still missing. And that is an interface, an experiment where we interface an adaptation to social factors. So what do I mean with that? So in my understanding, social interaction is still a problem with AIs. I mean, we see with ChatGPT that it's somehow reflecting in a socially acceptable way. But sometimes it does not. I think we can agree on that it doesn't have a good understanding of momentary, contextual, social factors. So if you want to have a robot that is understanding us, it needs to be context sensitive, has to act socially acceptable, and it needs to have some kind of empathy. And we investigated that with an experiment where we want to answer the question, can a machine assess and interpret personal information in a social interaction in a realistic context? So can it really understand social cues? And we did that in a bluffing game. So why did we choose that? In a bluffing game, I try to hide my social cues. I don't want to show that I'm bluffing right now or that I'm not bluffing. And the question is, can a BCI detect that as reliable as a human observer? So we let people play a game against each other, and they were highly motivated. They wanted to find out, is my opponent bluffing? And then we compared the accuracy, the performance of that trained human player in the last 10 minutes to the BCI. And of course, the best and well-known bluffing game is poker. But we have a problem there if you do an experiment. Let's assume I have a pairs of seven on my hand and do an all-in, like put all my money in. Am I bluffing then or not? I mean, how would you know? Maybe I'm really convinced because I saw the other social cues, they have nothing, so I can go all-in, I will win. Or I'm just completely bluffing because I say, pairs of seven doesn't matter, but I can scare them out, so it's fine. So when you do an experiment, you would never know that in the moment. You can ask later, but then, of course, you don't want to interrupt the game. You want to have them continuously playing. So we chose a different game where we have the deliberate attempt to mislead an opponent in the game, which we call bluffing. And that's quite German. So I'm introducing you to a game which is played by German students a lot. It's called Maxian or Mayan. And basically the idea is you have a group of people and you roll two dice. But only you see what we rolled. And then you communicate a number, which could be what you rolled, but it could be also something else. And the first person is doing that, and that's saying, I have a 32, handing it over to the next person. They didn't see that, you only know that. And then they have to roll. And if they continue, they have to tell a higher number. And they have to decide whether they bluff when they have rolled lower, or whether they tell the truth, or whatever. And the thing is, if I bluff and I'm detected with bluffing, I have to drink some liquor. And if you think I'm bluffing but I didn't bluff, you have to drink. So that's the game, basically. And we did do that with two players only and without alcohol in the US, in San Diego. So the people didn't know the game. They were on the same level of experience. And let's say player A rolls a 34. First round, they, of course, announce 34, even though she could have bluffed. And player B could have doubted it and say, I don't believe you won 34, but of course he accepts that because of the first round. That's really not difficult. Then player B rolls a 45 and he says, yeah, I rolled a 45. He could also go a higher number to make a little more pressure on the next second player, but he didn't do that. And player A accepts that, okay, 45 is not that unlikely. I accept that. But then she rolls a 26. And she announces a 63 because she decided to bluff, but she'd have also quit. And player B is doubting that. So player A loses 2 points. So here players had 20 points. If you're detected bluffing or wrongly accused of bluffing, you lose 2 points. If you quit, you lose only 1 point. If you nothing happens, you keep your points. And the round ends, and then the next round begins. So you start with 20 points, and you win when your opponent has 0 points. There were 8 games for each pair, and you would get $5 per point you have in the end. So when you really play a perfect round, you could get $100, which is quite exciting. And we equipped players with 128 channels each, and there is a social component because they could watch each other. They could see the body posture, the facial expression, and whatever, and try to arrive whether you're bluffing or not. And here you see the decision tree. If you rolled higher, you can tell the truth. There's no loss. If you take a risk, if not, you can take a risk and bluff, or quit and have a small loss. And in the end, you either detected or not detected. And we compared bluffing against no risk, basically. And here you see the ERPs. So zero was the time where you announced the numbers, and you see the EG activity where the solid line is bluffing and the dashed line is telling truth. on two different channels. And this was the data we provided to the BCI to classify. And we used 1 hour of data to train the BCI and also gave the opponent the chance to understand you for an hour. And then we compared both the BCI and the players on the last 10 minutes of the game.
So you had eight rounds?
Yeah.
Some of them?
Yeah, basically on the first 7 rounds we trained it, and the last round we tested the
system. 7 rounds trained,
yeah.
And then last round
yes,
was
exactly. BCI. So now let's look at the performance of the human. So they had a detection rate of 65%, and here you see the true positive and false positive rate. So in 2/3 of the trials, they were accurately detecting whether you're bluffing or not. I think that's not too bad. I mean, after 1 hour, people assumed they were better than that, but they weren't. But you know, 50% would be chance, and 65% is better than chance. But the BCI was at 75%. And that's significantly better than the human. And let me give you a little bit more details about that. So the player, of course, had a lot of information available. They could see your behavior, but they also would know the numbers. If I really rolled high, it's very unlikely that you would roll higher. So that is, of course, biasing my decision whether you bluff or not. And so that the game statistics and the whole duration of your body, bodily exposure. And the BCI had only 400 milliseconds of EEG, nothing else. 400 milliseconds only when you announce the number. And it went, it's 10% better than the human. That's significant. So we have set up a technical system that can detect human social behavior in a better way than a highly motivated human observer. And that made us and the robot smile. I mean, that tells that the power of a BCI, I think, a passive BCI. I think, how would any other system derive that information without having access to your brain activity? So we see that this is context sensitive because it's really dependent on the moment it's happening. It's socially acceptable because I understand bluffing is usually, if you're a good bluffing detector, then you're a cool person. And if you bluff well, it's also highly, it's different than lying. I don't think it's a lie detector. And of course, it shows some empathy. I have an understanding whether you're lying to me or not, whether you're bluffing. And I will not go into detail on that, but I was approached heavily by the US military after they saw that. And they really tried to convince me to, in a really interesting way. We'll not speak about that. But
It's recorded.
It's recorded, so I'm a little bit. But what I can tell is I did not work with them. At the time, it was 2011 or something, I decided not to do that. But I also think it wouldn't help them much. They wanted to use it for interrogations, they told me. And I think that's a different signal you emit. When you're bluffing, it's really something different because it's socially not acceptable to lie and it's acceptable to bluff. Okay. But now let's come to a conclusion. So I think with the last study, we can think about empathic machines, socially aware machines. You know, I've been told multiple times when I grow old, there will not be a person taking care of me, but it will be a robot. And I understand that this robot probably can do its task really well. I really believe it will not harm me. It will take rather good care of me. But when I look at my father and other older people, I see there are different moods in different days. Sometimes he's really happy if he gets some support, and other days he's not happy, but he wants to try himself. And I believe a robot today can't detect that well. Of course, if my father would say, nah, I want to do it myself, it would understand it, but if somebody takes care of you, you won't have the feeling that they understand you, that they have a feeling for you, that they're good to you. And I don't say the bluffing detector is now this, the thing that's solving the problem, but it shows potentially what you can do with a passive BCI. And please look at how BCIs are usually perceived. It's direct control. And what we're doing here right now is something very, very different. So we might have empathic machines in future that not only support our elderly people, but also interact with us in a better way. And there we come into the alignment problem we'll discuss later in the 5:30 talk. If we think about AGI, if we think about a well-working AI, we want that this system is sharing our values. That's understanding what we think is good or bad. And I think it's difficult to implement that. We discussed that. Everybody's discussing that. How can we solve the alignment problem? OpenAI had a super alignment team, and it didn't work out well. And I truly believe if we make a machine empathic, it automatically can derive this compassion, this understanding of our values. And I really believe we should do that. If we create an AI, we should use the human brain as a tutor, as a teacher for that AI. And I believe that this is enough to make it aligned with our values. So with that, we can provide a solution to a highly debated problem, and nobody has a solution for that. And that's maybe the most important part I'm saying today in this session. But of course, there's always a dual use, right? I was now showing you all the things you can do and we want to do and how the world could be, how good the world could be if you use a passive BCI. But I skipped through the study, but I think you understood that you can use a BCI together with eye tracking. Yeah. And then you focus on something, you read something, and you get a brain response. Right? Here you see where people focus their eyes on, and you understand they were perceiving something there, and then you get a brain response. And let's say not only one BCI, but let's assume you have 15 BCIs, which give a bigger, more detailed description of your mindset. And then you would know how you react to that world, to that word. And now let's go to Facebook. Let's assume Facebook convinces you, or any other social media network, to wear an EEG cap while you do that, because you can play games or something is better. Then they would know exactly how you react to each word you're looking at. How you react to ads, do you like the ad or not? But let's also assume they're not doing this direct reaction thing, but they do a model. They create a user model about you. And they know you like politician A, and they know you don't like politician B. And they know your favorite color is yellow, and you don't like green. And let's assume Facebook or another company wants you to change your opinion. They want you to like politician B and not A. Then they could depict the politician they want you to like in your favorite color, or anything you like. They know it about you. And of course, that's nothing new. We know that already, the micro-targeting that's already available. And you see here a picture I took from the Metcalf study from 2019, where they describe different levels of micro-targeting, where you have a nebulous population, and you learn something about that, and then you micro-target this population where you learned about. And when you know something about market segments you're interested in, you can react differently to them. And that was a big study where they discussed how bad or good micro-targeting can be. Now imagine you don't only know the market segments or some data of the people, but you know how they responded with their mindset to things. You get a very detailed description of these people, and you can do way stronger micro-targeting. And I think that is going into neuroadaptive mind control. And that's a strong word, I'm aware of that. But if you are in your filter bubble, we all know that term, and you know that's nothing new, it's really old stuff. And you provide your personal data and get your targeted ads, and that is so fine-grained that they really understand in detail what you want, what you like, what you don't like. and they can modify everything you perceive in your filter bubble in a detailed way, they can control your thoughts to some degree. And that's also nothing new. Advertisement is doing that all the time, but this is a way more powerful thing. So I just want to mention that, that this is a downside. And I think in general, when we go into the new world where we have AI, passive PCIs, whatever available, we can try to regulate. We do that very strongly in Europe. But that will not solve the problem. The only way to solve that is by having aware people, people that know what they're doing. They know what it means. And that's something I would like to ask you. You know, I'm presenting a lot of stuff and ask you to listen to me, but I know I ask you to do something. Go out to people and tell them. Make them aware. That's our, you know, we are aware of these things. And we need to, it's our responsibility to tell people that there are good things and bad things happening with the tech we develop. And we have to take this responsibility, otherwise our societies will break down. I'm really convinced by that. But okay, to end not with a negative statement, I would like to pinpoint once again to the talk at 5:30 today, where we'll talk about the solution to the alignment problem and talk about how AIs can learn directly from the human mind and become better with that. I will provide two examples and also speak about something which is in our European world quite big. So I'm not only a professor at Technical University in Cottbus, but I also own a company called Zander Labs. And we received half a year ago a funding of 30 million euros only for this company. So we don't have any partners, and we can use that to bring passive PCI technology to the world and build demonstrators for new adaptive AI, artificial intelligence that learned from your mind. And surely 30 million will not be enough to solve this problem, but it will enable us to solve problems like we discussed today, like the bottlenecks with electrodes, the calibration time, and we can also showcase applications in serious scenarios where this works out. And then the real work starts, of course. But and I will speak about this project more detail tonight, and the main focus is about neo-adaptive AIs. So, thanks a lot for your attention. And one last point. I mentioned it early on. There is a society I started together with Stephen Fairclough from the UK in 2017. And we are dealing with these problems. And if you like what I discussed today, I would like to invite you to come to Berlin early next year. That's far travel from the US, I understand that, but some of you are from Europe, maybe more likely that you come over. But we'll have a conference in Berlin in April, maybe May, so I'm not there. It's not decided yet in Berlin. And if you go to neoadaptive.org, that's a website, you find, it's not online now, but in a few weeks we'll see it online. And I would like to see you there again and discuss things further with you.